It's good to have everybody visiting. We're glad you're here, and we want to get right into the Word of God and preach today. And again, be careful while you're traveling, and especially while you're walking out here in the parking lot, to take care on that. Numbers chapter 21, and we're going to be looking at this and then some other passages of Scripture. Pray that I can feed the flock of God today, and that the Holy Spirit of God will, you know, just pray while I'm preaching, because if God doesn't do something in our lives, why, there's nothing done of any value to us. Might be even worse than nothing. And when King Arad the Canaanite, which dwelt in the south, heard tell that Israel came by the way of the spies, then he fought against Israel and took some of them prisoners. And Israel vowed a vow unto the Lord and said, if thou wilt indeed deliver this people into my hand, then I will utterly destroy their cities. And the Lord hearkened to the voice of Israel and delivered up the Canaanites, and they utterly destroyed them and their cities. And he called the name of the place Hormah. And they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom. And the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way. You want to watch that. It's no sin to get discouraged. Just don't stay there. It's not a sin to get discouraged. Just don't hang around there very long. Gird up the loins of your mind. Make up your mind and not staying in this state of mind. Because discouragement can do some things to you that won't be good for you. And it'll bring you down. You'll notice the next thing that happens in verse number 5. And the people spake against God and against Moses. They got discouraged. And because they didn't conquer and deal with that discouragement pretty quick, then it began to move through their lives and manifest itself in their lives. And this turns out terrible. Wherefore, they say, have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? Same old story, same old junk, same old complaining. I don't know. Are we like that? Have you said this year, can you believe all this snow? I'll tell you what it is getting. I'm like, can you believe how cold it is? Winter's just hanging on. You know what, folks have been doing that for a long time. I don't care what Al Gore says. And next summer, it'll get hot. Can you believe how dry it is? And then, can you believe it's been raining for 5 days straight? I wonder when it's ever going to quit raining. You know, if you get to thinking about it, it just seems like we're just constantly just, you know, I mean, I don't care what happens. Somehow or another, we're just not totally happy with it. And so I just say that to encourage us and myself to think about, we may not be so much different from them than we think. But anyway, they said, there's no bread, neither is any water, and our soul loatheth is light bread. Well, anyway, there was nothing to make them happy. Now, I think God, I'm just honest with you about it. The older I get, the more I realize how grateful I ought to be. There's Amanda. Hi, Amanda. How are you doing? Have you got a little baby back there? I'd like somebody, like, you know, I want you somebody to show that baby the congregation. This is his first Sunday outside the womb in church. And a snowy day. Amen. Amen. Well, I can't believe I've got 10 grandkids. I mean, that's just like, I ought to still be telling the boys, boys, time to get up. I ought to still be trying to sort through their boots to find mine. Boy, I mean, life moves on in a hurry, don't it? Good grief. And, but anyway, verse number 6, here's an amazing scene in the Bible. One thing I like about winter, the snakes are all underground. You can go out and cut wood, there ain't no copperheads and junk. I was about 2 or 3 years ago, a tree fell on a fence, and I went over to cut that tree off, and a big old round tree, and it got into it, and it's hollow, and I cut that tree in the middle, and there's no black snake. And he just barely moved a little bit, so I chainsawed him. I tell you, I've never have liked snakes. I don't like any kind of snake. I don't like to be around people handling snakes. I'll tell you one thing, the only time I ever come close to me and Don's in having trouble was over a snake. He likes to play snake tricks, and he likes these little fake snakes, and he thinks that's funny. How many people want to tell Don it is not funny to drape a copperhead fake snake over your brake pedal? How many, Don, that's not funny. He likes to see women go out the top of the car and all kinds of things. But in this passage of scripture, and I don't want to get started on snake stories here, but anyway, verse number 6, the Lord sent fiery serpents. Somebody said, Reggie, are there fiery serpents? There sure was here. Fiery serpents. What's a fiery serpent like? I don't know, but I don't want to be around one. I'm telling you what, that'd be bad. The Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much people of Israel died. Therefore, the people came to Moses and said, we have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that he take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent and set it upon a pole. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. And Moses made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole. And it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. And the children of Israel set forward and pitched in Oboth. Go to John, just hold that, if you will, and go to John chapter 3. One of the most important passages in the entire Bible is in the book of John chapter 3. It's the passage of scripture where we read John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. But right before Jesus said that, he goes back into the Old Testament to this story. Now that tells me that this account is very, very important that we're reading, that there's a message here and a doctrinal truth that we need to get a hold of. Verse 14 said in John 3, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. If Jesus mentioned that just before he quoted or gave the verse John 3:16, referring back to this Old Testament account and telling us what its doctrinal thing is, believe. Simple, isn't it? These people were to look at the serpent and they would be healed. Simple. And so Jesus gives that in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. You don't need to turn there, but Paul there talking about these children of Israel, and he warns about they tempted the Lord, and he said God sent serpents among them. I'll tell you what I thought about that scene. If I'd been in the camp, man, that'd be a horrible thing, Sister Pearl, to be in. You wake up in the morning there, and you wake up, and there's a fiery serpent. You step out of the house, there's a fiery serpent. You go down the basement, there's a fiery serpent. You go to do your work, there's fiery serpents. And all around you, people are being bit. The next thing you know, you're bit, and it killed people. It bit you. It killed you. I'll tell you what, I ain't never seen a fiery serpent, but if I seen one, I'm telling you what, if I had a double-barrel shotgun, I'd just hit it and hit it and hit it. I mean, you're talking about something mean, a fiery serpent, and it bit them. And I'll tell you what, they had trouble. It was serious. And so we're going to look at this thing this morning, and it is a picture. Certainly serpent is a picture of the devil. The Bible talks about in Genesis chapter 3 that Satan, he was a serpent, and he came to Eve. Clear into the book of Revelation chapter 20 and verse number, it says that old serpent, the devil. Over and over again, it represents Satan. The bite that the serpents were giving him represented the effects of sin being injected with the curse, with sin, and sin bringeth forth death. It pictures sin, it pictures Satan and what's happened to humanity. But this passage of scripture gives us the cure for the bite of sin. How many here has been bitten by sin? How many has been bitten by the serpent? Every person in this building has been bitten by sin. It is a picture of Satan. It's a picture of sin having bitten the person. But what God tells Moses to do about it is a picture of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is a portrayal of that. And that's what I want to preach about it today. This is not just, and I don't have too many more messages to finish up on the life of Moses. But boy, if there's ever a picture of the gospel, it's right here. I'm assuming that most people in here are saved today. And so I hope you'll just sit back and enjoy hearing again another portrayal in the Bible of the story of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. So everything that happened in Numbers 21 is seen in the salvation of our Lord Jesus Christ. Number one, the source of our cure. What cures you and I our sin bite, the serpent, the sin that's in our life? What cures it? First of all, here is the source. Did you know Moses didn't come up with the cure? And the people didn't come up with the cure? The source of the cure of the serpent bite came from God. And the source of the cure for sin comes from God. Amen. It doesn't come from denominations and churches and preachers and Christians and other places and philosophers and all kinds of stuff. The source of salvation comes from the Lord. The Bible said salvation is of the Lord. I'm going to tell you something. Man can't save you. Mom, daddy can't save you. Nobody else can save you. Salvation is of the Lord. The source of it comes from God. Don't ever forget that. Because if you don't understand that cardinal doctrine of truth, if it comes from anywhere else, it is not a salvation. If it comes from any place else, the Bible's a lie. It comes from the Lord. God is the source of our salvation. Totally, 100%, God is the source of our salvation. Man is the one who is saved. Man is not the one who's doing the saving. It is all of God. Number two, the strangeness of the cure. Now this is interesting. First of all, we have the source of the cure. It absolutely comes from God, not man, but the strangeness of the cure. God told Moses, he said, I want you to get a pole. And he said, I want you to make a brazen serpent. And he said, I want you to hold it up. You know, I would never have thought about that. Nobody else did, but God did. He said, make that brazen serpent, put it on a pole. And he said, everybody who looks at it will live. That's a strange cure. By the way, the insignia that's on doctors' offices and pharmacies and so forth, you'll see this pole with the serpent around it to this day. That tells you about our Judeo-Christian heritage. Where did the doctors in the 18th century and the 17th century get the idea to put a pole on the side of their building with a serpent in it? They got it out of their Bible. And what they were saying was, we are healers, but we're not trying to take the place of God. We're here to serve people and help people. And so I just want to throw that in to say that that in itself tells you the Judeo-biblical Christian heritage of your forefathers. The gospel seems strange. The Bible said that the preaching of the cross is foolishness to the Greeks. It's a stumbling block to the Jews. It seems like craziness to the average person. But Jesus Christ crucified is what the Bible said. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 2 and 3, we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block and unto the Greeks foolishness. This world does not understand grace. People think that they need to do something. I'm sure they thought, if you'll go do this, or if you'll go do this, if you'll do this, if you'll do this, or not do that, or not do that, or not do that. It was none of that, and that seemed strange to those people. Men think, surely I must do something. It's like Brother Paul said, and Paul, thank you for the message, and you need to be listening. What he's saying to you is critical. It'll make more critical, because either this book is real or it's not. And what he's teaching you, get your ear on that thing. But he talked about Connie's mother saying, it can't be that easy. Been raised a Catholic all of her life. It can't be that easy that I could just call upon the Lord. Surely there's something else I must do. But the gospel is strange to a lost and dying world that thinks they've got to be merit themselves or be good people or do something. It's free. It's grace. But there's not only just the strangeness of it. I'm telling you what, all across the world, you look at your religion. What does a Muslim think he's got to do? He got to four times or five times a day bow down toward Mecca, and he goes on and on and on down the road, but he's never sure for sure. Unless he martyrs himself, killing a bunch of infidels, he's not sure. And even then, he's not quite sure that he'll go to paradise. What about Catholicism? They never know where they're going. They die not knowing for sure where they're going to go. Most likely they're going to go to hell or purgatory, because almost nobody makes it straight to heaven. And so how long will I be in purgatory? Who's going to pay me out? Who's going to pray me out? You talk about the Hindus and your Buddhists, by the way, and I'm telling you something. I dare you, I challenge you to say this thing of the strangeness of it and the sufficiency of the cross of Calvary. They cannot tell you with the certainty of the Word of God that you're going to heaven when you die. But I raise this book up before you here today and tell you this, that in Christ Jesus, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the Son of God. He that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son of God hath not life. God says you can know that you're saved. This is the gospel. But to a lost and dying world, and to the slave, the religious slave masters, the religious slave masters, Mormons, Jehovah's Witnesses, Catholicism, Muslims, cults, denominational junk that tells you if you don't do this, that you'll be lost. Those are religious slave masters. And your flesh wants to think that you can do something to be saved. But God is different. God says it's of grace. the sufficiency of the cure that God gave him. Look at verse number 9. It says, if a serpent had bitten any man, the sufficiency of God's cure. Did you know that God can save anybody that'll call upon him? Whosoever is a gospel, our gospel is a gospel of whosoever. If any man will call upon the Lord Jesus Christ, God will save him. Amen. The Bible said, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you're here today and you never called upon the name of the Lord to be saved, I'm saying to you today that God will save you. Don't let the devil let you sit there in your seat today and say, well, I've gone too far, I've done too much. God's grace is sufficient. Where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. And the cross and the cure is sufficient. Hebrews says this, that he is able to save to the uttermost. Amen. Amen. He is able to save to the uttermost them that come to God by him. Our cure is sufficiency. The Bible teaches here that all who looked upon that brass serpent were healed completely. Amen. The Bible teaches us clearly, whosoever will. That's why we need to take the gospel to the ends of the earth. So it's not just the strangeness of it and the source of it, but the sufficiency of the cure. I'm glad today, listen, I'm glad that the blood, Paul, I'm glad that the gospel is sufficient. It is Christ plus nothing. It is the gospel plus nothing, amen. I'm glad that it's sufficient for us. But there's a singularity to the cure. The serpent of brass, now listen to me, was the only thing that could cure him. It was the only thing that could cure him. They weren't to look to it, plus quit chewing tobacco. They weren't to look to it, plus get your hair cut. They weren't supposed to look to it plus anything. It was singular. Look at the brazen serpent. God said you'll live. Did you know God saved you in the mess you're in? That's the old time saying used is, God, we're supposed to catch a fish and God to clean them up. Oftentimes we're trying to clean the fish before we ever catch them. You get them caught, you get them saved, and then God will clean them up after a while. Amen. When I see somebody that will not let God clean them up, I know they ain't never been caught yet. Amen. So I'm saying this to you. It was a singularity of it. There was no other means of any kind could save them. Some of them couldn't look at the cross, and then others go down to the creek and take a drink of water. Others couldn't do this. It was everybody. I'm glad today that everybody has to come to God the same way, through the Lord Jesus Christ. I often get tickled hearing people, and I wish somebody would invite me to debate a Muslim somewhere. Because the first thing I'd like to do is say to that Muslim, do you believe that Jesus Christ is a good prophet? Yeah. It's the first thing I'd ask him. Amen. And you know what he'll tell me? Yes. I said, right, I'm going to ask you this question. Do good prophets lie? Promise you he's going to say no. All right, Jesus Christ said that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man come to the Father but by him. The Bible said neither is there salvation by any other, under any other name under heaven. There's none other name under heaven give among men whereby you must be saved. Jesus said, I am the door. By me, if any man enter, he shall be saved. So Jesus says that Muhammad's not a way and all of your stuff's not a way. It's him alone, Christ, singular, nobody else. So that makes either, if you believe he's a good prophet, you don't believe what he said, he's a liar, why do you call him a good prophet for? You know why you're saying that? Is to dodgeball Christianity and Christian people listening to you. You're saying he's a good prophet so you don't lose their ear. Because you know, if you told the truth about what you believe and called Jesus a liar, nobody would listen to you any longer. That's the truth about the matter, isn't it? Bless God this morning. I'll tell you right now, he's the only way to heaven. It's not through the church house door and baptism door, speaking in tongues and all that other junk out of hell. Amen. Amen. I tell you, people, some messed up in this country is crazy. They'll get you to the altar, beat you over the chest 42 times there, and then after you 3 weeks later tell you you're still not saved because you ain't spoken in tongues. Well, you didn't get saved. You didn't babble. I'm tired of that. I am tired of that. You know what, Paul? We'll condemn these Bibles for taking out the blood, but what's the matter with us? Why don't we get serious about these people who really don't believe it either? Right. They'll say them, they'll talk it with their mouth, but if you ain't spoken tongues, yeah, some of you's amen turned off there what just now, didn't it? You know why? Because your Uncle Joe speaks in tongues and you just know he's spiritual. That's why God didn't call you to pastor in this pulpit, because you'd be too afraid to say it. God have to do something in you that he did to me. What, the night I got saved, surrendered, and preached, I told God, I said, if you don't do something in me, because I'm sick and tired of hearing preachers who are afraid to preach, if you don't put something in me that gives me the guts and the courage and the love to preach what needs to be preached, I'm headed south or west or somewhere. Yeah. Worst thing in the world would be called to preach and need to preach and won't preach. I'm saying this for this morning, that it's singular. There's not any way. Jesus said, I am the way, not a way, the truth, the life, and no man come to the Father but by me. It's the only way to go. You ain't no other way. It's singular. And then there's the simplicity of the cure. Boy, I love this. Look on it. Do you know what Isaiah 45:22 says? God says, in fact, the verse number above it, verse 21 says, he's the Savior. He said, look unto me and be ye saved. Simple. Can I tell you something that I've struggled with for years? And I want to tell you, old customs and traditions are hard to break. You ask a man, you ever been saved? He said, well, I was down at camp and I went forward. I was at Bible school and I went forward. I was at Liberty Faith Church and I went forward. Now you listen to me this morning. Going forward does not save you. I think that going forward in the Protestant Bible-believing churches has become our little mass. Sometimes we wonder why our children have been, we say, man, something's wrong. Something's wrong with their profession of faith. They have no desire for God. They have any desire for God. They love the world. You can tell they're bound in church. And the problem is that we've preached a going forward. Let me tell you something. You can go forward till you fall, till you ain't got any reverse left in you, and die and go to hell. It is Christ's substitutionary death, believing in that, that saves you. That he died in your place on the cross, was buried, and rose again. It's looking unto Jesus. It's not going forward. Now, I believe this. Most people that ever went forward got saved before they ever went forward. I really believe that. I don't know. You know, I don't want to make anybody irritated. You said, bless God, Reggie. I went forward too. I knelt down an altar too, and I'm thankful for that, and we don't use these like we ought to. The truth about it is, if we'll go back in church history, these are not places to get saved. They were called mourner's benches. That's the old term. And the mourners that they were talking about, number one, the people who were mourning over their sin to be saved, okay? And then secondly, those who were already saved who were mourning over the sin that they committed as Christians. It's called a mourner's bench. And the reason they called it a mourner's bench is because they did not want to call it an altar, because the Catholic Church had altars in it. And our altar is the cross, and that's a one-time sacrifice. That's why we really shouldn't call these altars. Now, it is an altar in this sense only. If you come up here to sacrifice, lay your body on the altar of God as a sacrifice, presenting your body a living sacrifice, in that sense, maybe you can call it an altar. I'm just saying this to you, that if we're not careful, we'll condemn other religions and stuff for having a bunch of junk and baloney that we know is not right. But we've got traditions and customs that I'm not too sure about. And one of them is, and I'm all for, you know, I'm all for coming forward, all that. But I'm going to tell you something. You've been around the block like I've been. I've seen hundreds of them come forward, and then you couldn't find them. And I do not believe in the doctrine of follow-up. It's not in the Bible. Paul did tell him to train other men, but that's a different deal. Let me tell you what the Bible says. It says, follow us as we follow Christ. A man that gets saved will want to find who's serving God, where are they serving God at, and I want to follow this thing. They will follow if Christ is in them. Sheep follow. You don't have to drive them. Here's the thing I want to get to, the simplicity of the cure. The Bible said, watch this, in Hebrews chapter 8, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. I love that verse, because some days I'm looking at Reggie and it don't look very good. Some days I'm looking at you folks and it don't look very good. And some days I'm looking at the government and it sure don't look good. And you know what? The Holy Ghost reminds me, Reggie, I didn't tell you to look at yourself, and I didn't tell you to look at your either your successes or your failures. I didn't tell you to look at any of that. I told you to look unto Jesus, the author, and keep your eyes on the Lord. It's pretty hard to stay discouraged when you're keeping your eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm so thankful that it's simple. Amen. Look, here you are. You're bit. You're dying. Your arms are swelling. Your throats are swelling. Here comes the religious crowd. All right, brother, here, let me get down beside you. Now, try this. Try. Come on, now, try to speak in tongues. Come on. Here's another one. Come on, brother, get down here to the baptismal pool. Come on, hurry. I ain't got time to make it. The road's too slick to the creek. There's a tree down across the road. No, all they had to do, boom, they were healed. Now, I want to tell you something. The gospel's simple. And Paul warned about in the New Testament about getting away from the simplicity that's in Christ. I'm so thankful. It's not rituals. It's not ceremonies. It's not man's ideas. I want you, well, that's in 2 Corinthians 11:3 is where it talks about that. I'm glad it ain't money. I'm glad it's not merit. I'm glad it's not joining a group. And I went through all of it. Let's move on. It's just simple. If you check the men in the Bible, Paul and Silas sit down at the Philippi jail. Earthquake comes. You know, they're all loosed. Philippian jailer comes running in there. Men and sirs, what must I do to be saved? Well, Paul said it starts out like this. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Boom. Same thing. Simplicity of the gospel. Ethiopian eunuch. You just go all the way through the Bible. Believe and be saved. Believe and be saved. Believe and be saved. Believe and be saved. Just so simple. And here's what I don't like. They'll go with you on that far. Maybe I'm off on a tangent. But I can't help it. When I get this thing salvation, it bothers me. I want to ask y'all a question. If a guy gets saved and he smokes, and he don't stop smoking, will he lose his salvation, or was he ever saved to start with? Isn't that a funny question? But the really truth about it is people are asking themselves that all the time. Now, I'm asking you all this morning. I know the answer to it. Guy says he got saved. He smokes when he got saved, but he never does quit smoking. They put him in the casket, and he's still got a Winston hanging out his lip. Is the guy saved? That's exactly right. Nowhere in the Bible does it say in any way, fashion, or form that if you smoke, you're going to go to hell. Let me ask that. How about dipping skull? Now, this is serious. If a man claims to be saved and he dips skull and never does stop, is he saved? Exactly. It doesn't say in there if you could. Now, Uncle Bud Robinson said, he said, you can go to heaven and chew, but you have to go to hell to spit. Now, I'm going to, if I can this morning, I'll dig out all this garbage that's in our churches and in our subtle doctrines. Now, I believe in repentance. But the flat truth about it is there's lots of stuff that you don't agree with. You don't think ought to be done. That ain't got a thing in the world to do with being saved. And if you say so, your occult works. You just mark it out. I'll mark it down. You just hang on to your hat. You don't tell the Pentecostal tongue guys that claims they got to speak in tongues that they're messed up. If you're going to say that chewing tobacco, you can't go to heaven. Right. I know. Hey, some of you kids. Hey, did I say I want you to chew tobacco? He heard. Did I tell you Zen boys it's all right to smoke? I didn't, did I? I think it's ungodly, wicked. I think it's nasty. In fact, if it is, if you boys think chewing is so cool, I want you to put a good old big wad in your mouth next Sunday morning. If you think it's so spiritual and so good, put a great big wad right there. And then walk up to the girl you've been watching here in church. Hey, baby. let a little of it drool right down through here and say, hey, baby, I've been thinking about asking your daddy if I can marry you. If you really think it's cool, boys, do that. How many of you girls are going, oh, I can't wait. I just said all that. I think chewing's nasty. Looks like he got diarrhea of the mouth. Mercy, mercy, mercy. There's a rumbling going, there's a murmuring going through the country. Well, I don't tell you what I hate worse. You know what I'd rather have, though? I'd rather have, where'd my spittoon go? There's my spittoon right there. I'm talking about the simplicity when God told him, I know what God said. All right, look, Moses, you tell him put that serpent up there, and then you tell him this. You look up there and then come bring your cigarettes and lay them on the altar. Ain't what it says. We better get this thing straight. You better quit adding to the gospel. You better quit binding people up. How many of you women are glad that the gospel is not looking at the Lord Jesus Christ and being submissive to your husband? How many of you would make it into heaven? Raise your hands. This is fun, Jim. This is fun. Oh, she's not submissive. I believe you ought to be submissive, husband. But you know what I believe more than that, Brother Larry? I believe husbands ought to love their wife as Christ loved the church before he ever says a word about her being submissive. And that jackleg that's all the time talking about being submissive, and won't love his wife, he's a hypocrite. Yeah. Sorry, low-down thing. No wonder your kids don't want nothing to do with Jesus Christ. Oh, my land, somebody has spit in this thing. You're kidding me. You want the guy to...
No.
No, okay. You're looking forward to next Sunday, I bet, ain't you? Here's the thing I'm trying to get across to them. Us good old Bible-believing Protestants, if we ain't careful, we're adding things. We're adding things. Now, I think there's lots of things you shouldn't do. And I believe if you're saved, God will whoop the hide off if you don't quit doing it. In fact, I've experienced it. How many's experienced getting the hide whooped off of you? Because God's, first of all, God spoke to you and said, now, listen, you're saved, son. We'll cut this out of your life once you... Here's what the Word of God says. And you said, fine, that's... You know, and you went on down your way. You didn't change a bit. Pretty soon, here comes God. Co-whop, you found yourself laying on the backside of the ditch. What happened to me? Amen. Just here not too long ago, you know what I did? I put off something I knew I should have done. I knew I should have done it. Clearly, the Word of God. And some of you, if I told you, you'd think, well, Reggie, that ain't nothing. But it is to me because I'm a preacher and because I've been around the road 30 years. And I think, you know what? I don't expect the same thing out of them when they're this young and when they're this young. There are different things you expect. I've been 30 some years down the road saved. You know what God said to me? I ain't putting up with you. You ain't going to put me second, third, or fourth, or fifth in your life. It's going to be number one, Reggie. And you ain't got no excuses. You get up and preach to them people, put God first. And then you, in this area of your life, you did not. Kaboom! Karen, did I not come to you? And I said, we got to take care of this. Didn't I? I'll tell you what, I got the socks whooped off of me. Now, I don't like whoopings. I don't like whoopings. When God gives whoopings, he whoops. And took care of it, had peace about it. Couldn't hardly sleep. I said, school counselors, got to get this taken care of. And it just, one of them things. What am I carrying this around for? I know what I was going to do. I would rather have Kenny James walk in here every Sunday with skull streaming down his both sides of his mouth. You wouldn't. Sitting right there and spitting to hit that about every 5 minutes while I'm preaching and missing 82% of the time than to have one long-tongued lizard in this church house who's sowing discord. I'm going to ask you a question. Is it looking unto Jesus as the author and finisher of your faith, plus never gossiping? As bad as I hate discord and gossiping, that ain't part of your salvation. But woe be to you when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ. But I'm honest with you. You say, Reggie, if you had to pick this morning, 15 tobacco spitters or one long tongue lizard, I'd say, give me 35 spitters. That's what I'd tell the Lord. But can I say something to you? Not gossiping is not part of being saved. And I just think, you know what? I'm going to stand before God. It ain't going to be very long. I might stand before God tonight, and I might stand before him 30 years now, but it ain't going to be very long. I want to make sure when God said, Reggie, I called you to preach the gospel, that I preach the gospel. And I don't ever want to mix grace with works and make you feel like you're lost or can't be saved or you lost your salvation because of something you did in the way of works, because it ain't got nothing to do with it. He didn't say anything. But he said, look, and you'll be healed. You'll be saved. Well, got to run. I don't know whether I was preaching then or what I was doing. The next thing, it's supernatural. Did you know salvation is supernatural? Man alive, here they are. They're bit. Their arms swollen up. Their neck's swollen up. Their tongue's swollen up. They're fixing to die. And it's a lie. Hey, look, look, look. He jumps up. All he did, raise his head. He looked. Boom, he was healed. That's supernatural. That ain't Benny Hinnon. Amen. I've always said, Benny Hinn's got what he says he's got. Why don't you just go to Cox Medical Center? Start there. Why don't you just go down to the nursing home? Fix all them people up. I tell you, that's a bunch of nonsense. You know what's funny to me? Am I just too hillbilly or what? But I could tell by looking at him. I didn't even have to listen to him. I just said, that guy's off base. Weirdo. He's phony as a $3 bill. Some of you ain't bucked enough hay bales and picked enough rock to spot a phony. You sit around listening to Orpher Winfrey till you can't, you couldn't spot one. If 47 of them prayed it in front of you, you'd go, oh, that's awesome. Salvation. Boy, I don't think I'm meddling and got preaching now. Salvation is supernatural, amen. It's not what you're doing. Salvation is a supernatural act of God. God puts a new man. He creates a new man inside. A new creature. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. It's a divine nature imparted to you. It's regeneration. It's being born again. It's the work of God. When you look to Jesus Christ, God, the Holy Ghost, birthed a new creature in you that no man can do. It's supernatural. Being saved is supernatural. That's why it's not water baptism. Anybody can dunk you. It wouldn't be supernatural if it's water baptism. I mean, a clown can dunk you. Woo! Supernatural. Supernatural. Salvation supernatural. Made a child of God. Forgiven. Karen, did I mess my hair up? I never will forget. It was already messed up when I got here. I know. I never will forget one Sunday I went home. She said, you went like that and your hair was. She said, I couldn't pay attention to what you was preaching on because your hair was everywhere. Listen to Romans 1:16. God says, Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. Paul said, I ain't interested in all this religious nonsense. He said, I'm interested in the gospel. I'm interested in that look into Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, because that's what has the power in it to save people. The church can't save you. Mama, daddy can't save you. The priest can't save you. The preacher can't save you. Acts and Reformation can't save you. It's the gospel that saves you, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and it is supernatural. Now, I like this in here, the suddenness of it. Verse number 9 says, and when he looked, he was healed. Verse number 9, Moses made a serpent of brass, put it on a pole, came to pass, if any serpent bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. Not 2 hours later, and let me get this to you, not after he died. Mercy. Did you know most churches in this county teach that you cannot really know you're saved till you die? You won't really know where you're going till you die. That's what they really believe down in their heart of hearts. If you get them out beside the church and really nail them down, all right, you guys believe in salvation through the blood? Yeah, we believe all, believe in grace, salvation by grace. Yeah. When do you get saved? Well, you won't know till you die. You won't know till you die. I wouldn't give you 3 pennies for a religion that you couldn't know you're saved now. I'm telling you what, you can know you're saved, and you can know now that you got saved. And when God, and whenever, by the way, when you look to Jesus Christ, He saves you instantly. Somebody said, Reggie, how long does it take to get saved? Boom! That fast. The second you look to Jesus Christ, your heart receives Him as your Savior. God saves you right then. Not after He died, not 2 days later, but salvation is immediate. He was saved, they were saved instantly. It's a beautiful, beautiful picture. The Bible says that we're passed from death unto life. But there was a stipulation to this cure. In verse number 9, it said, any man. Nobody could look for somebody else. You had to look yourself. Hey, you Piss boys, you Wilson boys. You're going to have to make sure you get saved personally. Your daddy being saved won't save you. You'll bust hell wide open if you don't get saved personally. And every person has to look individually. Salvation is a personal thing. Mom and daddy couldn't look for them. Salvation is intimately personal. You must look unto Jesus Christ. You must see a dying Savior dying in your place for your sin. You must look at the empty tomb where He arose. By the way, folks, this shows the falseness of infant baptism. You see, when you preach the gospel in its purity in the scripture, it exposes all the false cults. Infant baptism is somebody doing it for you. I've never in my life understood why they would be so cruel as to baptize an infant. And then tell him all the time he's growing up, you were baptized when you were a baby. You're okay. And if some of you in this building that were baptized when you were an infant and you've never been born again, you're not okay. You're lost. You're lost. I'm sorry. But the gospel, this here proves that, that right there just proves the false doctrine. There's no salvation by proxy. You know, I've pounded this for years. But I continuously see it. It's amazing. This is 33 years now. It's amazing how many generations, how many, I call them sets of young people I've seen pass through this church. And invariably, there will be some who you can just tell they've never had a personal deal with the Lord. They're riding on their mom and daddy's faith. And when it comes time that they have to face themselves about what they believe and why they believe it, they're gone. And you're going to find out one of these days who you are and who you ain't. You know what I'd do? If I was every one of you kids in here, I'd say to you, you know what? My mom and dad took me to Liberty Faith Church for all these years. And they said this, this, and this, this. And Reggie, get up and preach this, this, and this. I'm going to get in the Bible and find out this right. Do yourself a favor. Don't let some cult walk by you and toss a little stupid something in your brain to make you doubt the truth. Get in this old book. And then if you find that it's not the truth, go to your mom and dad or come to me, you know, and say, hey, Brother Reggie, I read this, and you've always preached this by the blood, and it's by grace alone, and you preach these things, and here's what I found in Scripture. I'd be glad to visit with you, and I won't tear your head off. And by the way, don't feed me this line of nonsense, well, you won't listen to anybody. I'll listen to you if your heart's right and your attitude and your motives are right. It's just that I ain't got a lot of time to put up with a bunch of nonsense when I know you don't want help. You don't want to know. You got an issue. But you know what I'd do if I was you kids? I'd find out, hey, you know, were my mom and dad right? Because pretty soon you're going to have to find out, you know, if you just coast along on your mom and daddy's faith, you know what? You're going to blow out. You're going to blow out. I promise you'll blow out. It has to be personal. It has to be personal. You have to come to the cross. You have to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You have to come to Him as a repentant sinner needing a Savior. And the thing that bothers me in a lot of our homeschool, Christian school circles is we're kind of like trying to carry our children on our backs, you know, to glory without them having a personal thing. And we're we're imposing all these things on them without them understanding why. And that'll come back to bite you. Then there's the accessibility of the cure. It was near, whether he was near or far, it didn't matter. Whoever, wherever, poor, rich, anybody, didn't make any difference. They could look. Whosoever will could look. The accessibility of the gospel is to anybody. Anybody who calls on the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to tell you something. I believe this with all my heart. I'm going to talk to you now. Bob just told me this morning that the president has issued an order, so forth, for the Assyrians for how many? 7 million? 7 million Assyrians are coming to America. Open the door for them. Under the guise of getting away from all the atrocities and so forth. Let me tell you what's going to whip the Muslim faith in this country. The gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. And I want to tell you something. I believe with all of my heart that Muslims will get saved by the millions if they're ever freed from the bondage of not being able to hear the gospel. And what the church needs to do, I'm all for, and by the way, I am prepared. I mean, I'm loaded for bear. I've got it set so this church could probably last for months. Okay? If we had to duke it out. Just keep that in your back pocket. But I want to tell you something. What we need to focus on is not how many we can mow down. We need to focus on how many we can win to Jesus Christ. That's what we need to be doing. And I'm telling you something, we better get aggressive. We better get on the ball. We better get the gospel and not be ashamed to call an ace and a spade and to let them know they're bound in a false religion. Plant that seed of doubt in their mind. They don't have anything anyway. Let them know they're lost. Challenge them. Listen to you, Paul walked into those marketplaces where they were worshiping idols everywhere. He walked up there in Acts 17 to Mars Hill. He walked in there with the gospel of Jesus Christ and turned the world upside down. Amen. And I believe, I'm praying, this is what I've been praying. Oh God, raise up in America young men and young women who's not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, who will with holy boldness go to the Muslim people, to anybody with the gospel of Christ. Let me tell you something, but it really ticks me off. They want us to let them come in with their junk, but we can't go to Saudi Arabia and our military people can't even have Bibles with them. That's nuts. I'd tell them rascals, I'd say, I'll tell you one thing. You want our help militarily? We're sending in preachers or coming in with the first wave. Bibles and preachers are coming in. They don't come in, we don't come in. You don't tell us leave our Bible at the door. I don't think it's right to let them in like that. I think it ought to be reciprocal. We let you in with your Koran. You let us in with our Bibles. We'll see which one comes out on top. I could preach on that till the moment. But anyway, it's accessible to buy. But there's finally the supporting of the cure. You know, John 3:14, Jesus said, as Moses did something, he lifted that up. Now here's where you come in. And this is what we need to get out of this message today. This church, our families need to get this message out of this. Supporting the cure. There's one thing God told Moses to do. Moses, hold her up where folks can see her. Now, I don't know tonight whether I'll do it or not, because I don't know what the weather's going to do yet. I'm supposed to get 2 degrees tonight. That makes me want to build a house, throw 3 blankets on, and go to bed. But if we come back tonight, I don't want to preach on how are you lifting up the pole. John 3:14, Jesus said, he said, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. In John chapter 12, I believe it is, where Jesus said, yes, verse 32, he said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. Let me tell you something. We don't, and I want to say this to you. I've never, ever felt like we ought to promote Liberty Faith Church in the sense of promoting it. I'd always felt like we shouldn't be ashamed of who we are. But we need to be lifting up him. Not Liberty Faith Church. We need to be lifting up the cross of Calvary and the message of the gospel to people. And God said this. This is a promise from the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, and I, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. You know what we need to do? We don't be lifting up our denomination, our this, that, or the other stuff like that. We need to be lifting up the Lord Jesus Christ. That means we need to be lifting up. Lifting up the Lord Jesus Christ in a practical sense means this. It's when the men go to the jail and lift up Jesus Christ to those serpent-bitten men and women. And how many times, fellas, have you been to that jailhouse? When you lifted up the Lord Jesus Christ, they looked and lived. That's what we need to be doing. God, he really spoke to my heart. He said, Reggie, you know, all these things you do, that's fine. But he said, in all thy ways acknowledge me. How are we lifting up? We need to lift him up in the papers. We need to lift the Lord Jesus Christ up in the newspapers. We need to lift him up on the CDs and on the internet. We need to lift up the Lord Jesus Christ from this pulpit. But we need to personally lift Jesus up in our workplaces. There's some people in this church who have a business, and here a while back they were telling me about some smart remarks that people made about their carrying their faith into their workplace. Let me just tell you this. The very fact that they did that means that you were having an effect upon their lives. The very fact that it bothered them, the cross, which is a picture of this pole, is offensive to this world. You know what I want in this church? And I want to encourage all of you, because I'm just like all the rest of you, I'm out among people. But I want us to lift up the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what we need to be doing. Not worrying about a lot of this other junk. Just keep him lifted up. And I know that involves proclaiming the truth, preaching against sin, all this other. But I'm telling you what we need to lift him up. We need to lift him up in the workplace. Don't anybody tell you that you can't lift up the Lord Jesus Christ where you work. For if you can't, then you have certainly lost your freedom. You know what I'd rather do? I'd rather lose a job lifting him up than stand before God, have been ashamed of it. Every time, all the time, where we can, I want you to think about where and how can I lift up the Lord Jesus Christ? What time is it, somebody? I'm going to quit right there because I changed gears right here. Isn't it a beautiful picture of the gospel? Isn't it amazing how the Old Testament, you know, no wonder when Jesus, you might have never heard of cows fixing to get up. That's bad analysis, but it kind of reminded me of that. Y'all ought to know better than that by now. No, seriously, you know, let's stand. Let's stand. Brother Dennis, I appreciate, I'm going to do it. This ad costing you $35. They have a little place down there called, what is it, Scoopies? Scoops. Has a Z on the end of it. Scoop Z. Okay, Scoop Z, all right. Anyway, they got up on the board down there and says, teach your children about taxes. Eat 30% of their ice cream. I love it. I love it. But you go up there to pay for your meal, he's got gospel tracts there. They do. I appreciate that. You may say, well, that ain't a whole lot, but they're doing what they can do, wherever they can. That's what I'm saying in our workplaces and what we do. Don't be afraid to put a verse on your card. Or Kenny, I noticed in your advertisement that you have a sign of the fish or something on it. Anyway, let you know you're a Christian there, cross or something. You know, and I want to tell you folks, and I want to encourage you today, lift him up. Lift him up. If we're not careful, we're lifting up our standards. Our standards of what we don't do or what we do instead of lifting him up. You lift him up, the right standards will go up with him. Amen. Lord, thank you for this day. I pray, Lord, you give these folks a safe journey home. And I pray, Lord, that we'll know this truth. That if men will look to Christ and Christ alone, plus nothing else, they can be saved. God, thank you that you made it, Lord, so simple, so sure. Lord, we love you this morning that you are the source of our salvation. God, I just pray that you'll encourage these people today to the point of where it'll be their joy and fun. It'll be their rejoicing to go every day of their life lifting up the Lord Jesus Christ to somebody along the trail. Lord, there's a lot of ways we can lift him up. Ways, Lord, that sometimes we wouldn't think about. Maybe we didn't think about. But God, I pray you'll show us. Lord, we love you. Thank you for letting us worship you today. Thank you, Lord, for the roads being so folks could get here. And I pray, Lord, that you've been lifted up, that you've been glorified. Lord Jesus, I thank you for allowing yourself to be lifted up, to die in our place. Help us never get over that, Lord. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.